right. So good evening, everybody, and welcome to the January 6, 2016 Select Board meeting. We have a little technical problems with our recording right now, so we're not live. We're being pre-recorded, and then we'll probably jump into the session halfway through, and I'll not know that, but you'll see us just show up. So here we all are. We have a consent agenda. On the consent agenda, we have the minutes from December 2nd. We have warrants AP 1625, 1626, 1627, 28, 16 PR 1625, PR 1626, PR 1627, PR 1628. We're doing annual license renewals for Flavors of Cook Farm, Fuji Chen, Wendy's, and Hadley Auto Service. Temporary foreman appointment for the DPW, an appointment to the Joint Transportation Committee, a resignation we're accepting for one of the dispatchers, and that's it for now. Is there anything anybody wants to take off for there besides the committee vacancies, which I just took off?
No. Motion to accept the consent agenda.
Second.
The temporary foreman and dispatch, I can't vote on.
Okay.
Do you like to take them separately, or you want to just...
No, you can just
excuse myself from those two.
Yes.
All right.
I'll abstain from the appointment for the joint transportation.
Temporary foreman DPW.
Hey, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 With the noted abstentions?
Dispatch. Resignation.
All right. The one item I took off was the committee vacancies. So we have a good many committee vacancies. Do we want to go through them now or just want to...
Well, we were talking about that today. We have some vacancies for Cultural Council, Cemetery, Long Range Planning. We have an election that's coming up with some openings. What we thought we would do is we would post this on the website and solicit interest, as well as an announcement in the newspaper to get people interested. I know that this was an issue that was raised in the public hearing for the master plan, that it was hard for people to feel like they were plugged in, and considering that we have vacancies on some of these boards, and at its heart, Hadley is a volunteer organization. Since we have some of these vacancies on these boards, that we would get the word out and see if we can connect with some of the people who are raising those concerns at the master plan public hearing.
All right. Okay, I just figured out the camera angle. It's freaking me out a little bit to not see the camera. I got it now. All right, so we have lots of we have a few vacancies. If you're interested, please check back. It'll be advertised in the paper. Call town hall if you're interested in serving on some committees. And we do appreciate everyone who joins the committee. Makes us a little easier for the rest of us to be on and get town government working well. So thank you. Okay, so this is the time now usually we set aside for public comment. Is anybody here just want to throw something out in public comment? No. Okay. All right, we'll take the L of business number two first, since we have some time before our appointment.
Sure.
So just an update on Holly Road and Laurel Drive. We have for Holly Road, we had 13 abutters that we sent out letters requesting that they waive liability for damages for the acceptance of the road. This is a legal procedure that would reduce the risk to the townspeople for when we actually do take over Holly Road for as a public way. We've received 12 of the 13 waivers back. And the one that we're missing is from an abutter who is off to one side, is not directly in the roadway. And so I'm thinking that we go ahead, my recommendation is that we go ahead and file the paperwork to accept this, because you have 12 abutters who directly abut the road surface that as it's currently paved, and one abutter who's non-responsive who's off to one side and is not going to be part of the actual road surface, and so would not have any real claims to damages. So I think we've done our due diligence, and I think it's time to move forward. We have until mid-February to complete this project.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so the motion is to continue on and not take this one signature.
And not let that one, lack of one signature be an impediment to acceptance of the road.
Okay, any other discussion? Don't see any audience? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
So we'll move forward, and then we have to have our, so our formal vote on this will be probably the first meeting in February?
I think we've done your votes, so I think everything's now in place for us to record it in the Registry of Deeds.
Okay, and we're all done. All right, so why don't we go to new business number two, the special municipal employee designation for consultants to the Conservation Commission?
They're going to be coming in.
I think there's someone out there now.
Let me double check.
You could have done three over the time.
I'm going to get them out here after the thing. Okay, so we're probably just being recorded now, right? So we can be edited out. That's dead air.
You're on the air now. They're seeing your picture.
But we're not being broadcast, are
we?
Oh,
there you are. Yeah, he fixed it.
I can't talk on the air unless I change the channel. But then
you're on.
Well, no, it might not be on the air.
Oh,
right. So you want to do number three while we wait for David?
No, we just lost David.
He went to find the commission that you sent him to look at. Here they all come.
Yep, we got one.
All right.
This is Janice Stern of the Conservation Commission.
Of course it is.
We have an issue with the finding consultants to work for the Conservation Commission on third-party reviews because recent enforcement of the state ethics law concerning the conflict of potential conflict of interest of representing before boards where hearings are occurring, and then taking work with some of the agencies that you've just represented in front of the Conservation Commission. You want to explain a little bit further?
So I called around and emailed around to some of the other Conservation Commissions to find out what they do in their towns, and some of them in the area do have this. It's called a special municipal employee. And the way that I got the explanation from the various agents and stuff is that it provides more leeway, and I guess you'd say more cover, for the consultants. There are consultants that come before on behalf of private parties in front of the Conservation Commission. But then when we want to have a third-party review, there aren't that many consultants in the area without going way out into Eastern Mass. And so some of these independent ones don't want to work for the town because they're afraid that if they've already served, you know, another private party in town, that it could be a potential conflict of interest. And two of them, at least, have told me that they won't work for the Conservation Commission on a peer review in town unless we have this designation. So I'm not sure that it solves all the problems. I did have a long talk with the Ethics Commission last week, and they said in the end, the consultant still has to come to them if there's any possible conflict of interest, just to be sure. But I guess this provides a certain layer of security or help for those independents that don't want to get stuck in something that could be considered a conflict of interest because they've worked with private parties and then they're coming back working for the Conservation Commission on a peer review. And I assume that it would also hold true if other boards in town hired a third-party reviewer or something like that as well. So I think it helps. It's not apparently the end-all on this, but it is an extra level of help to make sure that things can be done, that we can still get the third-party reviewers that we would like to get on our projects, and they'll feel comfortable doing it.
So just to be clear, special municipal employee status provides just minor relaxation from the requirements of the State Ethics Commission. It's certainly not a carte blanche to behave in a way that would raise questions about ethics, but it provides a little bit of relief from that.
And having special municipal employees is a common practice among small towns, particularly when there are fewer people to do the work of municipal government. The select board automatically is designated as special municipal employees for any town fewer than 10,000 population. So all five of you are special municipal employees automatically by virtue of the office that you hold. You have a number of other positions that are designated as special municipal employees. We can provide you with the whole list. The designation is for the position and not for the individual. So the position that we're proposing is on-call consultant, and that we would ask you to designate that as a special municipal employee status position. And then it doesn't matter who we hire, that person would enjoy the benefits of that status.
Do you use various people to begin with anyways? Or is there mostly one organization or person that you use?
We have two or three people, depending on whether it's stormwater or wetlands delineation, because those are different types
specialties.
Of talents. But some people have retired, and so it's gotten a little more difficult to be able to use the usual group that we've used. And some of those others have now gotten, you know, worried about a conflict of interest. So this time I've had to call around a bit to find a third-party reviewer for a project, and I just worry that it could get worse in the future. So I started talking to David about this as one way to hopefully be able to keep a few different people available rather than just having one person or two people.
I'll make a motion to accept the recommendation to create the designation for on-call consultants.
As a special municipal employee.
So the position that already exists as consultant to the, do you guys actually have a name for the position?
Whatever David thinks is.
On-call consultant.
Can we like on-call consultant for the Conservation Commission?
I think we're gonna see this problem show up in other areas too. So I would give us the flexibility to allow for the planning board and other bodies to use on-call consultants.
But it's for the position, like you say, it's for the position.
Right.
It's not for, so are you going to use the same position? I'm just trying to.
You could use it for
limit.
Planning board, board of health, select board, for anyone
is
who
it?
Needs a consultant.
So I'm just being a little weird. So is anybody else feel
usual.
Comfortable with it?
Yeah.
You're comfortable? Okay. No more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
All right, so it's 7:15.
So we have the Hampshire Council of Governments here to
President.
Talk to us.
Yes. Lee Frankel. Pleasure to meet everybody. It's my first time before this board. David, good to see you.
Good to see you as well. Happy New Year.
Likewise.
Thank you.
Where's Mr. Kubiak?
Yes.
Not available.
Jeez,
yeah.
we miss him. Tell him we miss him.
I'm a poor replacement.
No. Bernie used to work here.
I know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So he sent me in his stead.
Excellent.
I'll get cards for everybody. I'm the relatively new deputy director at the council. Colonial Power.
Here.
Ah,
Leo Sullivan.
Leo, we haven't met yet.
No, we haven't.
How are you, sir?
Fine, thanks.
Very well, thank you. Would you like to start off, or?
Whatever
shall
you comfortable with?
I'll frame while we're here.
There it is.
As everybody knows, the Hampshire Council had made a pass at municipal aggregation, which didn't go the way we liked. We were a little bit out of the box in our thinking, trying to take on a lot of work for a lot of small municipalities. Colonial Power Group, whom we've known for years, has a very successful approach to municipal aggregation, so that we recommended, because we remain invested in the concept, that people hear what they have to say. They've done dozens now of aggregations in the country.
30 plus.
Yep. And so Leo, whom
yeah.
I have not met yet, but has
right.
been with Colonial for a while.
I have also met Bernie several times. We've been to several of these meetings.
Yeah,
I'm Mike Sarzinski. I'm the counselor from the COG. I'm just curious, do you have a contractual relationship with the COG? I never figured that one out.
No, we don't.
Actually, can we step back up? Just explain the program and what you're proposing to us.
Yeah, we have a new service that sort of...
Can I ask a question? No.
Actually, can we just explain it and get started with saying what they're proposing to do, and then we can ask questions after that?
I think I can give some context to that. Say a little bit more. So Hampshire Council of Governments, through our Hampshire Power subsidiary, is a competitive electricity supplier in the Commonwealth. We serve many municipalities, municipal accounts, including this one, and save a lot of money for municipalities and for small businesses, for nonprofits. We also serve several municipal aggregations in the Commonwealth, where we're serving all of the town accounts that are on the default electricity service of their utility, which is the concept that Leo's going to speak to. The municipal aggregations that we serve as Hampshire Power, as a competitive electricity supplier, are managed by Colonial Power.
Which is solely our business. We are solely aggregators of the municipalities of electric power. All of the residents and all the businesses are put into one grouping, one purchasing group to purchase for the entire... I have a PowerPoint.
Go ahead. Yes.
Handout. I'm happy to discuss from. First of all, Leo Sullivan with Colonial, thank you very much for your time this evening. This is just a structured presentation of what our concept is and why we are here.
Thank you.
Do you have any more for the audience?
I don't expect this. So we are basically a consulting group. We've worked with 30 plus municipalities, cities, and towns in the Commonwealth. We are specializing solely in aggregation. We currently manage 35 communities in Massachusetts, and what this program is, it's an opt-out. Everybody in the town, with the approval of the town council, the select board, and the town meeting, which has already taken place. So the town meeting has already approved the aggregation. So that aspect of the process that is very heavily monitored by the state has been accomplished. So what we have been recommended to do from the recommendation of HCOG is to pick up utilizing our expertise in getting the petitions through the state, which all these 35 we have now done. So we have a pretty good track record of getting our overall petitions and plans through the state process, getting them approved, and then getting up and running. What we are hoping to do this evening is to get approval from the select board to proceed, and from that approval, we would post a plan which we have already submitted. Post it both on the website and on our bulletin board here in this town hall for 15 business days. With that in place and that approval being given, we can then petition the state, and that would take, by our rough estimation and the time frame that we've been experiencing recently, is approximately 2 months. So before the end of the first quarter, if everything was in place, we would expect to be able to start going out to the marketplace and requesting bids from the suppliers to get the local electric, both residential and commercial entities up and running at a much better rate. The market is extremely volatile as far as the pricing is concerned. We just went out to bid about 2 weeks ago now for the town of Holliston, and we were able to derive an 8.9 cent rate against, I believe it's a 10.2 currently in that town. So it's a significant difference. The market is very much in our favor right now. The market is quite soft as far as the pricing is concerned, and we are extremely competitive against the utilities at this current point in time.
So you'd be able to provide an opportunity for the people in town, the businesses, and the municipal residents to buy power through your company, which you would bid out and get better pricing for?
We would bid out. It wouldn't be our company. We would bid it out to suppliers.
Okay.
Specific suppliers that are geared solely for aggregation. Not all suppliers are capable or able to bid on that type of load. However, we have a stable of highly qualified and approved suppliers that we would go out, request bids, various terms, and various percentages of green, which is part of the whole decision process that would be offered to the board or whoever the decision maker for the town would be, to provide a larger share of green. This particular load here, which is mandated by the state, is 9% green. The example I just gave for Holliston, they elected to go 100% green at that 8.9 rate. So the market is very favorable, especially for green, so we have that opportunity. We don't have to, but what we would do is provide you various options on the level of green, the length of term that we feel is reasonable enough to get into at this point, given the market conditions and what they look like down the road, and then provide you with various options. We would make a recommendation on what we feel is the best one at that time, and then you folks just make the decision what specific rate and time frame you'd like to lock in. And then for that period of time, which it would be a year, 18 months, even 2 years, you would have a fixed rate that would be initially compared to the existing rate of the utility at that time. They change every 6 months, so we have to keep that factor in place when we are locking in the rates.
And is it the entire community, or this would be something that individuals would sign up for?
Everybody is put into the aggregation automatically. If you don't want to take advantage of the rate, you opt out. And a very important part of our process and our program is communication. Very important. We have a program that will include direct mail. Every single meter that would be in the aggregation would receive a direct mail letter explaining the aggregation, what the rate would be, for how long, and handle any of the various questions that are related to aggregation. It would be direct mail. We'd set up a dedicated hotline, the Hadley aggregation hotline, that we would handle questions from the residents and businesses. Direct mail, I mentioned newspaper ads, a website specifically dedicated. Each of these pieces of media would have the ability for the consumer to opt out if they so desired, or, I didn't mention, if a consumer is currently with a private supplier now, they would not be qualified to join this aggregation. However, most of them have escape clauses that they can get out of and then opt in. So you can opt, if you are not able to participate in the original aggregation because you are on private supply, if you can opt out of that supply, you can then opt into our rate. And so that's
just give an example of, because I'm confused, seeing I'm a homeowner and I have a business also, so we're Eversource.
Okay.
So how does that affect us?
The only difference that you would see if you were part of an aggregation, the only difference you'd see is the line item on your electric bill from Eversource. The last line item is for supply only, and that's all we're talking about, is the actual electrons, the supply. All of the other regulated pieces of your electric bill would remain the same. But that last line, which is electric supply, whoever the ABC supply company would be, they would be listed there for that exact rate. In the case of Holliston again, it would be 8.9 cents per kilowatt hour. And that would be on the bill, so you get the same bill. Technically, it's seamless. There's nothing you would see. You wouldn't see any difference anyplace, other than you get a lower rate for the time frame that we had specified. And then hopefully we would then go on to another term. The utilities change their rates every 6 months. So what we would do is, depending on what the market looked like and what the rates that came in on our bid, we would recommend a year, possibly 18 months. We don't want to go out too far because we don't want to get ourselves in a situation if the market comes off again, where Eversource would be below with the rate we are. We want to keep that door open and remain as flexible as possible to get the best rate we can for the town.
So it's not really Eversource's rate, it's the state default rate, correct? Eversource doesn't set that rate, the state sets it.
Which rate?
The supplier rate.
Supplier rate, no, Eversource doesn't set it, the state sets it.
Well, they have to apply to charge that specific rate.
Right.
But it's Eversource.
The state sets it.
I'm sorry?
The state sets it. Eversource isn't supplier.
The state approves the rate.
It's a state rate, which is really a false rate.
They go on to.
You can't help but beat it, that's what I'm saying.
So let me get, do you have anything else you want to say about your program?
I'm open to any questions anytime.
All right, let me summarize this and let me tell you if I got this right. You have come before us now to ask the select board to approve tonight for you to go out and bid for power for all the residents in Hadley.
Now, what we're here tonight to do is A, to introduce ourselves.
Okay.
As a aggregating company that has the largest experience with aggregation in the state of Massachusetts. What we'd like to do is to A, be considered, and also based on the recommendation of HCOG, that we be assigned the consultancy to take your town forward through the process to get you up and running at a lower rate as soon as possible. Because I believe it's probably been a couple of years since this was approved by the town meeting. So what we have the ability to do is to get you up and running as soon as possible, hopefully within the first quarter of this year.
And we have the authority to enter into this agreement based on?
Based on having had a previous town meeting approval of it.
So there's a power purchase agreement you have or someone has with this, and we're going to ride on this power purchase agreement? There's got to be some rules. The state has rules for everything.
There's no power purchase agreement. We haven't even got close to that stage.
There was an agreement to aggregate the town, to move forward with aggregation with the Hampshire Council of Governments as your consultant, your agency for aggregation, and the town meeting approved the concept of aggregation and going forward. The petition to the Department of Public Utilities for the aggregation of the town was denied.
Right, so now, if we have problems with this, we come to you? If homeowners in this town have problems, they come to you? We have an agreement with you.
Right. Right.
To aggregate our power. You're now having us to sub out the agreement.
You'd be looking at an entirely new agreement. We're recommending that if you remain committed to the concept of aggregation, that you consider Colonial Power Group based on our experience working with them.
So then if we are now going to be aggregating with this group, we now have to get authority from town meeting to do it with this group?
No.
How do you transfer a town meeting vote that said we'd aggregate with you to another agency that we have not done open procurement with
what's the cost?
There's no cost to the petition. The Hampshire Council, as your initial consultant in aggregation, bore all of the costs of preparing the petitions and putting them in front of the Department of Public Utilities. We were as disappointed as you were in the result, having the town committed to aggregation and then the petition failing to be approved. So in all candor, we didn't want to walk away entirely from the concept, but we're a small quasi-governmental nonprofit that bore a large expense in trying to get the petitions done. We don't want to move forward an aggregation consultancy and agency. We'd rather recommend that you consider, and Colonial Power Group is not the only group that provides this service, but they're one that we know well and that is based in Massachusetts. So if the town remains committed to the concept, we wanted to put our best foot forward. We want to do what we do well, which is power supply. We do supply a number of aggregations, a number that Colonial manage. We are able to put together as the power supplier, one of many who would bid on a contract for the load here, all of the green options. We do in Lowell is 100% green. We service that aggregation. Colonial Power Group manages it. That's really the extent of it.
What happened at the town meeting was that the town was authorized to go ahead with an aggregation.
With Hampshire Council of Governments.
our understanding is that you can...
That's true. I think you signed a contract with HCOG to be the aggregator, and that was, it took place 6 or 7 years ago.
That was with Jeff Rogers, you know, when he was
So, before I open up, there's more questions here, so I'm going to say my one statement, then I'll open up the other questions. I read through this, and I had a lot of questions about this. The one thing I do not see, I mean, you're asking us to say something now. I really think we haven't talked about this enough, and there's not been enough information passed out to the public. I'd love to see some information passed out to the public so they could actually give us some feedback. The opt-out, you have to opt-out. I always get concerned when someone tells me you have to opt-out of something. You're automatically enrolled. The military automatically enrolled me in a lot of things, and it kind of hasn't gotten worn off yet. So that's my big issue here. We entered an agreement with you. If there's problems with customers and issues with power, who do they talk to? You're saying not you, you're saying you. But town meeting definitely voted to enter into an agreement with you. So that's my concerns, and I'm going to open it up to the other select board to ask questions.
Well, I'm not actually going to express a concern. I just want to be clear about what I think I'm hearing. We, town meeting voted for Plan A. Plan A failed. We're very well publicized that Plan A failed. So as the HCOG committed to wanting to provide a cheaper, potentially cheaper, supply rate to the town residents and businesses in the town of Hadley, you're proceeding to Plan B. Your recommended Plan B is Colonial as one option, but I think as a town, I'm sensing that you are bringing the information forward tonight, but you're not asking us to formally vote on anything. You just want to make us aware that there is now a Plan B that you're recommending, and that clearly from a due diligence standpoint, we could proceed to engage in conversations through you with Colonial, or we could also look at some other option for ourselves.
Absolutely.
Right?
A number of towns that were part of our original aggregation plan have elected to go with Colonial as mm-hmm. the agent. They have a great boilerplate approach that succeeded 35 times through the Department of Public Utilities. Our understanding was that the town voted, based on our conversations on the back end, that the towns in their meetings voted for community choice aggregation. Mm-hmm. We were elected to be your agency for that community choice aggregation. Mm-hmm. Your petition didn't get through to the Department of Public Utilities. We were very creative and a bit out of the box in the creation of these proposals. Indeed, you didn't like it. So we have elected not to try to move forward with revised plans to be the agency to spend hundreds of thousands of additional dollars as a small quasi-governmental agency. It's really just dedicated to providing services to municipalities, but we didn't want to just turn tail and run. Mm-hmm. A lot of towns have active community choice aggregations. They're saving money for their residents and businesses with them. So again, we wanted to put our best foot forward and come up with our best notion of how to proceed, should you all, choose to do so.
Mm-hmm.
John? Yeah, so Hampshire County imploded on itself. Now, how are you going to bring us lower?
Okay, may I first clarify something right up front? My objective this evening to be here is A, not to ask for any decision tonight. This is an informational setting to answer any background questions, which I will address yours, but we're looking to answer any questions that you might have. We have submitted a full packet with the full written plan that we would be submitting to the DPU that should be posted. So all of that has already been submitted to the town and it's here for your reviews. And a couple of other documents are also in there. One is our agreement form for your review. One is an exemption letter that would exempt you from having to go out and do an open bid, which we fully are capable of addressing and working through, but there's a full packet on immediate next steps once you go through the process. Okay, to answer your question on, it was how do we get the lower rate?
Yeah, he just said that it was going to cost the county a couple hundred thousand dollars.
No. The Hampshire Council of Governments, in putting forward an initial plan for aggregation, bore all of the costs of preparing the petitions and presenting them to the Department of Public Utilities.
More than a couple hundred, too.
Well, yeah, when you look at all of the towns in aggregate. Because we were doing it on behalf of an enormous number of municipalities.
You've been aware of all of this, Mike? Most of it throughout this?
I was the original chair of the electricity committee at the COG, unfortunately. No, I'm kidding. It's been a learning experience.
Yeah.
The market is very complicated. Massachusetts has created this system. And within the system that they've created, it's my opinion that it's very likely a Colonial will probably save you some money. But the question that citizens have to ask is, why is the cost of electricity in Massachusetts one of the highest per kilowatt hours in the country? That's really the question that has to be asked. They're going to save money within the system that the state has created, but why are the costs of buying electricity in the state so high? I don't have a good answer for that.
I can answer that. The main reason is our physical location and being in the Northeast, furthest from the centers of where the oil is derived from out of the ground, that's number one. And then the infrastructure, the pipelines, and the infrastructure to get the natural gas and the energy into this part of the country is what's causing the most expense to it. That's the main reasons why.
So you're saying that the Kinder Morgan pipeline would lower the cost of energy in our prices?
I'm just saying the infrastructure is grossly inadequate for this part of the country.
So we have the packet. Personally, we'll take it under advisement. I personally would think we need to go back to town meeting with the proposal you have and let them town meeting choose the second.
I'm sure under statutes it's going to have to be bid up if we're going to go with something like that.
Well, I think we need to do our homework.
Yeah.
One of the documents that are in the packet explains that it's an exemption that does not require that you go out. I'm not suggesting you don't go out, but I'm saying to answer that specific question, you don't have to physically go out to do that by statute. That's one.
I mean, my attitude is that to the extent we can enter into an agreement that's going to save the taxpayers or the homeowners and the business owners any amount of money in a legal way, that we should pursue that as long as we have the legality of it behind us.
All right,
I wanted to make sure I addressed everybody's questions with regard to the Hampshire Council specifically. We have seen this transfer already happen from among our original group of aggregated municipalities to Colonial without a town meeting. That's not telling you the best way forward here, just what we've seen so far.
That's true. That's happened. A good half dozen already.
Yeah.
So we'll just take an information and advisement. We'll talk it over with our town council on whether we need to do it again, and then we'll go from there.
Could we ask David to pursue that? Again, you know, I don't want to delay if we don't need to. If we have to go back to town meeting, then we do.
And actually, I'd like to, before I would agree to join, and I would like to see some type of communication with the public, and so they have a chance to talk back to you and us about what their views are.
In public forum.
So that plan that is in the packet is the one that I mentioned can go on the website and can be posted downstairs on the bulletin board or wherever you do it. Mm-hmm. And we can hold other forums. I'd be more than happy to come back to another town meeting or whatever to answer questions.
Is there a time frame on this?
All I can say is the sooner the better for the town to be able to take advantage of aggregation.
Mm-hmm. One question, or a couple questions. Are you aware of any other New England states that have something similar to community choice aggregation?
I'm aware. You're asking me?
Yeah.
I'm aware of several states in the country. Jersey, which isn't New England, but it's the only state that is about at the same level of development as Massachusetts is. New York just approved about 6 months ago a test market in Westchester, and now also in Long Island. Ohio and Illinois are way down the road. There are over 900 cities and towns in those two states that are under aggregation. And in my judgment, this is the wave of the future of where electric utilities are going to go. But Massachusetts is the first one in New England specifically, but New York and New Jersey are starting up and running.
Thank you.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're ready for our 7:35 appointment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr.
So we're just
I'm not even sure what the state of the record here. What I've done is I set this thing up to record. Using this as the audio so we have a record.
Okay, thank you. All right, so we're ready for our 7:35 appointment.
I didn't test the bead, that's what happened.
Of course, Murphy's law.
So our 7:35 appointment is with the Pride LLC. They are here for us to hold a public hearing for a request for a off-premise liquor license and for a underground storage tanks in excess of 4,000 gallons. Before I open the hearing, is that correct?
Correct.
And you wish to keep going?
I guess just for a formality, I'll certainly introduce myself and just ask.
Well, we need to open the hearing first. You wanted to proceed?
Correct. I guess I'll just defer to the board. If you want to do one hearing first, close that hearing, open the second hearing, close the second hearing, and then vote, or how, just as a formality as to how it deferred you, as to how you.
How would you like to do it?
Individually.
You can do it together, or you can do it individually.
Is there a preference?
I think we had put the land license at an earlier time, so in the paper with the notice.
Okay, so we'll do the land license for the storage tanks. So is there a motion to open that hearing?
Motion to open the hearing on the storage.
Second.
Tanks.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so you're here to talk to us about permission to put fuel tanks in the grill.
Will there be a fifth member?
It will.
We can wait. So, the hearing is open. I didn't even see him walk out.
I didn't even see him walk out.
Well, you can introduce everybody.
Yeah, that'd be good.
I'm James Channing, Corporate Counsel for Pride. I'd like to think Happy New Year, hopefully new beginnings. With me tonight is Bob Boldick. Mr. Boldick's the founder of Pride, as well as the president, Marcia Del Monte, to his left. Behind her is Richard Hoffner. He's the director of operations. To his right is Amy Correa. She's the corporate trainer for Pride. And then to her, behind her, is Sheldon Collins. He's the compliance director for Pride. And lastly, to the last, but certainly not least, the proposed manager, Larry Williams, for Pride.
We've seen three of you before.
Keep that vote.
President counted for, sir.
All right.
Everything came out fine.
All right, so.
So the way I foresee it, just as a general overview, I'll defer to Mr. Boldick as to the project, I think.
We're actually doing the gas tanks first, and then we'll do the second part.
I'll defer to Mr. Boldick for an overview of the project and then get into the specifics of the storage license. From a technical standpoint, we're asking, pursuant to statute, chapter 148, section 3, for three separate tanks, two different types of fuel, one being a 31,000 gallon gasoline tank, in addition to a maximum quantity of $10,000 diesel fuel, as well as four 1,000 gallons of propane tank. So it's for the whole parcel. We conferred with both Conservation Commission as well as the fire chief.
again, at this point, I think it's appropriate for Mr. Bolduc to talk about where the tanks potentially would be proposed, as well as any specifics with respect to the technical aspects of that request.
What would the propane tanks be used for?
It would be for heating. It would be 4,000 for the entire obviously, we're still optimistic that the moratorium may be lifted, but we're in a position to prepare. We will go forward, obviously, with our, regardless of whether or not the moratorium is lifted, but we're in a position to identify that.
Are they going to be underground or above ground?
All underground.
It was my recommendation to include the propane tanks in this land license request, simply because of the process. So the original application, it only included 800 gallons. So we revised that to make sure, because he's also looking to do a Blue Rhino exchange program. So the land license, just to clarify, it's not for storing tanks. It's for the storage of flammable combustible fluids, solids, and gases. So it doesn't have to be, everything on that site needs to be incorporated into that total. So the bottles of oil that they sell, everything has to be factored into that limit.
Okay, go ahead.
Good evening.
Saw you last night on TV.
First I should say, as you saw, I just spoke to Janice and Paulette, and I'm sure you've heard about the latest confusion. So I'd like to just address that just for 1 minute, okay?
That'd be great.
Yeah. We're going to work it out. There was a misunderstanding. I think both sides agree to that now. We've just been talking about that. We got to the bottom of it. We do have and did have the proper demolition permits, and apparently there's a communication gap between conservation and building. In that building, to my knowledge, forever, you get a demolition permit from the building inspector, you have satisfied the law. It turns out in your town, the conservation feels that they should have a say on that, and they weren't notified, and therefore they are very upset that we knocked the buildings down. But we did do everything necessary to demolish the buildings, as you know. We got electric removed, we had water removed, we properly kept the sewers, we got permission from DEP, we got permission from State Highway, we had the tree warden in there to look, your tree warden in there to see that there were no trees that he wanted to save. As you know, it took a long time, we did absolutely everything. DEP was on site when we were demolishing the building. They approved everything. We did everything in our power to see that everything was done properly. And conservation feels that they should have been notified. So that's what happened there. As for the trees, it was exactly the same issue, exactly the same problem. Our engineers will be meeting with Paulette and Janice next week. We've already arranged a meeting on Tuesday night. They're going to appear before conservation. And they will work out what happened with the trees, because our engineering firm, which is VHB, insists that there is no law in the books that says you can't cut trees in a floodplain. Ms. Kodeska, she's the chair, feels that there is. And so they're going to work that out. And they apparently know one another and have had issues before. VHB, not only did the Springfield office give us all the approvals, but they had people out from the Boston office, they're environmental experts, and they gave us the approval. On top of that, I have a letter in the file from Natural Heritage. We had them out, they walked the site, and they said there were no rare species of plants, there were no rare species of animals, and they gave us permission to demolish and to cut. I have the letter. Your Conservation Commission feels that they were wrong.
So
that's where we are right now.
Would you like to resolve the Conservation Commission issue before you continue with this?
Well, if that is, we talked about that, and if that is in fact hanging a cloud over all this, we would love to. Okay, because we really feel that should happen. Now, what I said to those two ladies a minute ago in the hallway was that. I said, basically, what do we do to make it right? Okay? Now, they've issued a cease and desist. I said, I really think we don't need to go that. I give you my word. I'll cease and desist without that. Just ask me to. I mean, that's as you would have seen had we gone forward tonight, that's the kind of company we are. I'm perfectly happy to do that.
So right now, it's...
if you think we should.
I'm a little...
We don't like the cloud either.
Okay, I'm a little concerned about it. I think anybody else, or we can keep proceeding.
You're concerned about what?
Resolving the conservation issue.
Yeah.
Before we continue go any further.
Yeah, I think we should.
And it sounds
to,
like they
yes.
can.
Oh,
you're
I know
hopeful
we can.
That you can.
Absolutely. I said to him, what do we need to do to fix it? And here was our plan.
Well hold on.
Go ahead.
I
understand.
So do we want to
hold off until
recommend they hold off and resolve this issue before they come?
Sure. Would you like to reschedule the meeting?
We'd be happy to.
Is that okay with the Conservation Commission?
Is that
what does the timing look like with you? Any idea?
We
if it's an unfair question, we can ask you later.
Well, we only meet once a month, and we have a meeting next Tuesday. And we've issued the enforcement order that will be discussed and ratified by the commission. And we will know where we're going from at that point.
So
have you gave them all the documentation you have from
yes.
all these other agencies?
Yes.
Okay, so...
Prior to this meeting.
Are we in agreement then that we prefer to have this, we put the...
you want to vote on
it? Yes, there's a procedural motion here where we continue the hearing. That's what we would do because we've opened it
right.
to
right. a date certain.
And then just
I mean, if you're just taking up the tanks,
I think we should...
And just to cross it, the I's and dot the T's,
yeah.
We should open the hearing on the on the liquor license as well. If we're going to continue that as well, if that's where we want to go.
Okay. So what is the board's?
Make a motion to continue the meeting on the underground storage tanks.
Second.
Any more discussion about it? Okay, so.
We need to set a date.
We'll continue it till, yes, we have to set a date for the continuation.
And then we're going to open the meeting
and then do that.
And do the same. Okay.
We have January 20th, we have February 3rd.
What would be best?
If it does require two, I think if you're looking at February 10th, that would be at least give two meetings for the conservation. I believe they meet the second Tuesdays. But if you think that it can be resolved next Tuesday, then
we'll go with
the
February 10th.
February 10th.
Yeah,
at 7:15 p.m.
7:15. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Wait a minute.
Oh. We'll just open and close the other one.
So do we need to all vote?
All in favor of that?
Aye.
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 Okay, and then I'll make a motion to open the hearing on the malt and wine off-premise liquor license being requested by Pride LLC.
Second.
Any discussion? Do I have a motion?
You do.
I'll make a motion to...
Oh, Toast, go ahead. Oh, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Sorry.
Make a motion and postpone it until the 10th. February?
Continue
to the 10th February.
I'll second that.
And 7?
15. 7:15.
Can you do them the same time or do you have to technically separate my couple of seconds?
Well,
motion open. Second on the floor.
Any more discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you very much and I wish you luck.
You.
And
okay,
we have full confidence and trust in the Conservation Commission that they're doing the right thing and you guys.
We'll yeah, we're going to
work it out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Styling, bud.
All right. So
you have our full support.
So please let us know how it goes if you don't. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We'll be in touch.
Thanks.
Thanks, Paul.
Why don't you tell him the day of the meeting and he'd be happy to attend.
We are meeting next Tuesday, so.
Lovely.
All right.
It's near the beginning, so.
So, thank you. Let's jump on our old business number one, the fire department. So the fire department management study review of recommendations for the FY 2017 budget.
This is something that you all asked to have on the agenda. Was there some focus? The chief has been working through that management study for a while and has implemented a number of the recommendations. Is planning more for FY17.
How do we make out with the first that we discussed at the last meeting?
What's that?
How do we make out with the first implementation?
The part-time? It'll be starting on January 18th.
Okay, so.
So can Mike summarize for us where we stand with the?
I apologize, but I was not aware that I was presenting tonight on this, so I don't have anything formal for that. Prepared for you, I have my contract negotiations with you tonight and mm-hmm. Pride. So I apologize if that was something I missed, but.
Okay.
Does anybody want to talk about the budget process while we're here with Ed in the park?
Do you have anything you want?
Do we have anything?
Oh.
We'll wait for his recommendations.
Okay.
I would prefer to wait for Mike's recommendations when he has a chance to provide them.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, if you recall the conversation, we thought it was kind of imperative that we understood, you know, refresh, get the cobwebs off, and refresh everybody's memory on the executive summary from that study so we knew exactly where we stood going into mm-hmm. the budget process so that we can make a more meaningful decisions relative to where to take your budget, right? So yeah, I mean, I agree. I think we need to, I want to hear, you know, from Mike when he has the opportunity to pull that together.
I also hope, Mike, that you, next Wednesday you'll be able to join us in the, when we have the group meeting so that you'll be able to express some of the needs of the fire department as we speak before all the boards. Thank you.
North and south.
All right. So
can we move that to the next regular scheduled meeting?
January.
So not next week.
Not next week. Week after. Yes.
Yeah.
Is that okay? And then your contract negotiations aren't on this agenda I have in front of me.
They should be on the second page.
That just says.
I think your books were done before we posted on Monday.
All right, so the agenda that I have right here.
Okay, I'm good.
You're so helpful.
Yeah. So we have contract negotiations for the fire chief, and we have collective bargaining agreements for the three unions, DPW, dispatch, and police.
Huh. Okay, so.
So when is the next, is it the 20th?
20th,
okay. So we'll invite Mike back.
He's always invited.
So I assume that both the chiefs are also here for the dispatch standard operating guidelines? Why don't we do that next?
Okay.
It's fairly simple, straightforward. It's essentially the exact same as the police. I don't want to take up too much of your time. I know David posted them for you. Apologize. We apologize for the length. They are shorter than the police. But one of the first things that I wanted to accomplish when I started was to revamp all of our internal policies and procedures. The police, obviously, we took care of that half, and anything new we present to the board. And as far as dispatch goes, with Mike finally being included in the operations of dispatch, we've been working together, as well as Sergeant Cook and several of our officers, putting together these SOGs and SOPs for hopefully a more professional communications center. They are all accredited level policies and procedures, just like the police, and we're pretty proud of the work that we had to put in to revamp everything, because I'm sure you know that what we had in the past was either non-existent or at a pretty outdated.
Well, and there was problems in the division of fire and police, and now that you've come together, it's, you know.
With Sergeant Cook handling our kind of impromptu dispatch supervisor, it really is working out pretty perfectly with Mike and I, that he is able to really actually oversee that department and identify the needs and be able to create the policy or SOG or SOP necessary to address the, any of those problems. So it's what we have put together so far, really coming along. We, you know, Mike still has some things he needs to add to it that I'm sure he will present. Same with the police side, as we come across things that we identify a problem or a need, the same thing will happen.
Are the staff members participating as well?
They are. The police, we actually, they were heavily involved. And as far as the dispatch side goes, a lot of it are things that we kind of have either, I don't want to say borrowed, but we look to other accredited agencies and pull these ideas in and speak with some of our staff and see whether or not these things will be applicable within our department. Mm-hmm. We certainly don't want to implement rules and regulations that we can't fulfill, we can't abide by. So that's really a lot of it. It's I don't want to say a trial and error, but there are some things that just won't work for our agency. So we're working towards that as well.
Any of that need to be folded into contract negotiations?
No, we actually worked pretty hard as far as both police and dispatch go to avoid any conflicts.
It could be at this point anyway, because you can't open up any new things to a contract at this point.
There'll be another contract coming down the road, and I would just assume that, I completely understand and concur with you, but well, now's the time to say it, because, 3 years from now, I don't want anybody throwing their hands up in the air like
Absolutely. It's
a new...
Absolutely.
New conception.
Maybe some things in 3 years that we would want to
address.
Incorporate into it.
Every day, we look at policies and procedures as a...
There might be several things we may
living,
want to incorporate for the next contract.
We look at them as a living, breathing entity. They have to be, we have to keep an eye on them, because everything is ever changing as far as public safety goes.
Do you anticipate any resistance to any of the SOGs or SOPs?
I'm sure there will be.
Just wanted to brace ourselves. Okay.
Same with the police.
Okay.
Everything—it's going to
be
the same, because there's rules where there were none, and some of the rules have changed.
Yeah.
So there will be some. I'm sure there'll be some issues. Nothing major, but it's a big change. It's a big change for some of the employees there. So the reason that we are presented the police and the dispatch now the way that we are is that we now are going to schedule a training and a dispatch department meeting to roll these out and begin to train people on how they work. We did that with the police. We're going to do the same with dispatch.
Well, thank you both for your effort.
So I just had one quick question. How is the SOG for snow days going?
Now I am going to crack you. I'll give you a snow day.
I don't get snow days either.
We get snow days?
No.
Thank you very much.
Snow days for everybody.
We want to call them professional days.
Okay. Right. Let's go ahead and open the annual town meeting warrant.
So I have prepared for you a preliminary warrant for the annual town meeting. Annual town meeting is May 5th, 2016, first Thursday in May. We had put together a countdown calendar where we identified today, January 6th, as the day that we would open the warrant for the annual town meeting, and we have proposed the date of February 17th for the closure. We always have business that we know that the town needs to engage in. So I've prepared this preliminary warrant with, I believe, 17 articles on it that will cover the main business that we need to conduct. And we can go through them very briefly if you wish. Or
I do not wish.
Okay.
Make a motion to open the warrant.
Second.
All right, for further discussion, I have a couple. So we just talked about the aggregation, so if you would check with council and see if we have to put an item on this warrant
mm-hmm.
to go with them if we choose to.
Right.
So that's one.
Right.
The second one is, how is the review going? We sent out the RFP for the North Hadley Hall for the other committees to review, and we gave them a deadline and we needed that information back. Mm-hmm. I lost my date. I think it's the end of this month is when we want that back.
Right.
So then we probably, based on that, we'll also need a article on the warrant for actually accepting a proposal this year. Mm-hmm. So we should probably go ahead and pencil.
To accept the bid price? I thought we could do that. We didn't have to go back to town meeting for that.
If we have, yeah, I think we do have to.
I think so. I thought we already were. Town meeting gave us the vote to sell the building.
They gave us the authority to sell it, but I don't know if we have to go back for any other reasons that might be in a proposal.
Well, can't you ask council when you ask any other?
I'll ask council.
Because if they come back with some type of other stipulations or things, we may have to.
I see. So some other kinds of lend lease, that kind of thing.
Yes.
I understand what you're saying, yes. Okay. So we have an article for North Hadley Village Hall.
And possible article.
Take care of it.
For aggregation.
Aggregation.
And those are the only two I could think of. Can anybody else think of anything?
No, unless something comes of the...
The planning board usually has some.
The building. I know the
building committee.
Yes,
then
after
something in here, but we may have something coming.
We may have more after our meeting next week.
We will. That's what I mean.
I know that there's an article for a pilot agreement for another solar project that's coming online. So
we'll number five.
This would be number five.
Wow, we're popular.
We'll have enough electricity in town to light up.
This will be a big one to bring in.
It'll be dark when I cover the bridge at night.
Tens of thousands of dollars if we get it.
Motion second on the floor, Chair.
Wait a minute. So go ahead. Go ahead and schedule that into there as well.
Yep.
Where's this one at?
Well, I'm not sure where exactly it's going to go, but it's going to be on the eastern side of town by UMass.
Yeah, you know put the things you don't really want next on the eastern side of your town in Massachusetts, I understand, because prevailing wind blows the smells. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, you're at the wrong town
wild tonight.
Session.
Sorry. Okay, motion is second.
You brought that up. In the older days, I thought they put it to block Amherst, but Amherst is on a hill.
It is. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Motion to close the warrant.
No.
Motion denied.
Actually, it's more fun being taped and not being live. Okay, so water and sewer rates.
Did you skip three? Are you going to skip three on the old business?
No, I'll go back to it.
Yep. Did they have to take that? Yeah, we'll circle around.
Okay.
We've been talking about the water and sewer rates for many years now. Just a little bit of history. In 2007, the Select Board raised water rates in anticipation for the debt associated with the Callahan Water Well Treatment Project. At that time, raised rates and kept them stable for a three-year period, in order to create a cushion for the project and then to fund the project. In 2009, we returned to the water rates and presented information that we needed to adjust rates in order to take care of future costs associated with the water department. We have not been able to successfully work on water rates since that 2007 implementation. So since 2007 to the present, the water rates have remained exactly the same. We anticipate that we are going to have more debt come on for the Water Enterprise Fund, particularly with the Route 9 water project. And currently we're subsidizing the water operations through water reserves, which indicates to us that the rates are not sufficient to cover our operational costs. And so that's the water situation for sewer. Back in 2008, there was a separate sewer commission. They raised rates by 4.5% in 2008. Then we combined the DPW and eliminated the sewer commission
We have not addressed sewer rates since that 2008 hike. We have new debt services associated with the sewer department coming online for FY 2017, and we need to adjust those rates in order to take care of some of that expense, keeping in mind that we have sewer impact fee account that can mitigate this debt service associated with the sewer project, so we have some cushion there. But in sewer in particular, we're using more and more of our reserves in order to cover the operation, and this is not a sustainable place for the sewer enterprise fund to be. And particularly, if we don't want to do something, we're going to have to make some hard choices about whether to continue with our capital improvement plan for the sewer department. So we have some major projects that need to be addressed, and so we need to talk about sewer rates as well as water rates. We have a long lag time between a decision that would be made now or in the next few months until when the new revenue would be coming in. If you made a decision between now and April 1st, we would not see that new revenue come in until February 2017. So we have to be thinking a year and a little bit ahead in terms of when we can anticipate that revenue. So Guilford was provided us with information about sewer and water rates and how they may be calculated. I received that information just now, shared it with the DPW director, who's not had a chance to look at his email, so he hasn't seen it yet. So we'd like the opportunity to review that information, but in the meantime, I did prepare some information about water and sewer rates that might be helpful. The first is the rate structure for both water and sewer. And one of the things that we talked about was on the water, where it says residential lifeline, usage of cubic feet from 0 to 999 cubic feet, receiving a charge of $2.25 per 100 cubic feet. If we were to eliminate that, that tier altogether, we would increase our revenues by about $60,000 as a conservative estimate.
Annually or per period?
Per annually.
Okay.
Get rid of which one?
The 0 to 999.
Right.
The first one.
So that's one way of raising some rates. The other is for the sewer. We looked, this is going to be a little harder to do. We looked at the tier. We thought maybe changing some of the tiers for the sewer would increase some of the revenue. The second page, I put together the total commitment for water and sewer from fiscal year 2008 through fiscal year 2015, and then did an 8-year average to see what the total commitment, the total money coming in for the for water and sewer charges would be. If we made a 2.5% increase on water and sewer, we would be bringing in about $27,000, $28,000 for water and about $17,000 for sewer.
Of new money.
Of new money.
Okay.
What was our shortfall last year?
Shortfall in the mind you, this is just for the rates. There's other income that comes mm-hmm. in, so we have septage income for the sewer. We have
backflow
testing. Thank you.
Sewer
plan review. So there's some one-time monies that come in, but for the recurring money, we're looking at $27,000, $28,000. For water and $17,000 for sewer.
That's the increase.
That's the increase.
Okay. What did we have to tap into our pre-existing accounts for last year?
We had to tap into something on the order of $40,000 for water, and north of $150,000 for sewer.
Unique instance on sewer.
Yeah. So sewer, we're gonna have to look at these rates over a multi-year period. I think it would be unfair to the ratepayers to try to make up lost ground in 1 year. We're going to have to look at this over a long period of time.
So the 3.5% is far closer to the actual.
No, not necessarily short. With other income.
So if you wanted to do 3.5% for sewer, for water and sewer, then you'd be bringing in 39 and 23 respectively, water and sewer, and a 4.5% increase would be 50,000 for water and 30,500 for sewer.
So are these the actuals, the 2015, of how much money do we actually have in the water and sewer enterprises?
That's just from the rates. Just from the rates.
What we have now, what do we have in there?
And for the
enterprise
funds.
We have something on the order of $400,000 in reserves.
Between the
for
two.
For sewer.
And just sewer?
Just sewer.
So we spent most of our sewer on Laura.
$250,000
We have about $500,000 in water.
Can I ask a question about the stormwater?
Sure.
Regulations?
Mm-hmm.
Are we even factoring any of that in yet?
No.
Do we have a plan for that yet?
Talked with engineers about it actually today, a couple weeks ago. They
see, teed it right up for you, Michael.
Proposal.
We'll see.
For doing the stormwater, I don't think we can really fit it into the water, the sewer. I was thinking of the highway part of it paying for the stormwater, since it's pertaining to catch basins, drainage, and things like that. It's going to be very, very expensive. I had three proposals, three different prices. The last one that I just got emailed today was around $150,000 for the first year. So somewhere the town is going to have to come up with that. The permit for the stormwater has not really been issued yet. It's one of these things you wait and see. If you need it, you have to do it. We have to do it at a five-year increment. He figured the 5 years, how much it would cost. It's a lot of money to do the whole program, but it's a mandate that has to be done. So I'm plugging it in into the budget under the new appropriations, new programs, to put it in a number of $150,000 if we need to do that. I mean, it's something that definitely is coming down the pipeline. There's no two ways about it, but just the cost of what they want the first year.
Coming down the pipeline?
Yeah, no pun intended.
The pipeline keeps coming up tonight, doesn't it?
We don't want to talk about the pipeline.
So this is something that's been on our radar for years now. We keep on thinking it's just around the corner, and we actually did raise money in the capital program for this, and it never came about, so that money was used for other productive purposes.
I mean, we've been doing the same thing every year with the stormwater. It's a sit-down session with a consultant. He has a whole list of questions that have to be answered. He submits it to the state. We never hear back whether it's okay, not okay. It's part of the permit process. So that's what we've been doing, and every year we keep hearing that, you know, it's going to change, it's going to get updated, and it's going to be very costly.
So who do we use for this?
We use Huntley for a while. We went to CEI on this for doing the actual permit, you know, the paperwork that's involved with it, you know, the requirements that are in place as they are now, but are going to be changing.
And how much is that, $100,000?
It's minor amounts of money. $4,000 to $5,000 the most for the stormwater that we've been doing over the past five years. We've been doing this since it started. It started out very simply as a one-page form, and as time grew, it starts to get larger. It gets into everything about the drainage system, when it was updated, catch basin cleanings, how often, where do you clean them? I mean, it's pretty extensive. GIS mapping, which we had a little meeting about. They would want all the ditches and all the drain lines on GIS, so it's gonna come to hit us sooner or later.
Have they talked to you about a utility yet?
About a what?
A stormwater utility?
No.
We've kicked that idea around, creating a stormwater utility program and maybe running that as a separate enterprise fund, which is where I think you may have been going with it.
Okay.
Until the regulations come out, we don't know what to, we're not quite sure how to structure it.
No.
And I think before we change any rates or anything, that we would have to have a public hearing. I would like to have public input.
Absolutely.
Well, that's a great idea, but you know, I don't think you can find another town that hasn't raised rates in 9 and 8 years, respectively.
I know that.
Yeah.
But people are going to want to be aware, and
people,
I think that that.
No, absolutely,
you
I
know,
agree
since
with that.
We're not really live here tonight either, we're kind of dead in the water.
So,
does DOR still request that we have 1 year's worth in the enterprise accounts as they used to?
They recommend it. It's not required, but it, obviously. Your own history shows that there are times when you need to use a lot of your reserves for unforeseen purposes. Before I showed up, I think you used almost $1 million of water reserves in order to prepare for the water treatment plant back in 2003.
So when is the date we have to make our decision by?
If you want to see the revenue in February 2017, you need to make a decision by April 1st, 2016.
Okay. So we'll just, in our budget discussions as we go along, we'll just put a couple more discussions along the way.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Just so you can make people aware that this is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Richard, is this actually going to get aired?
Yep. Yeah, he's taping it.
You're going to tape this and air this, right?
No.
Okay.
Are you live now? No. Okay.
Okay. So just so everybody out there, if you didn't get what's going on, is we're discussing raising the water and sewer rates. So, and we would like some input if you have any on what your view on it.
Gil, your home phone number is what?
Yeah.
555-1212. But you can email your questions to my email address here, and that's a much easier way to get me.
Yeah.
I can respond to you. Okay, so actually, we forgot to vote on the procedures for
the police and dispatch.
Well, we didn't vote on it because the content wasn't forwarded to us to review.
All right, well, we do that then.
Okay, actually, was in here though. That's true. We did. Can you forward the?
You were supposed to.
Well,
were supposed to receive all
if we
that.
Don't vote on it, it just is a. The chief could just institute the policies.
Yeah, I thought because we have strong chiefs.
After 30 days, it just goes into effect and just present it as a matter of a rule, I guess.
Okay.
Is
really,
that time
it doesn't
a problem?
Need to.
Yeah. Is that
no,
time
timing
a problem?
Necessarily isn't a problem. We were talking about scheduling a meeting, so it can be 30 days from now.
Okay. New business number 5. Solar City Corporation has a pilot agreement.
That's right. So the Hampshire College is developing, or has hired somebody to develop on their behalf, solar fields on their property in order to power their buildings and operations. One of those solar fields is on property within the town of Hadley. We've talked about it entering into a pilot agreement, a payment in lieu of taxes with them. We received a town meeting vote to authorize that for that particular parcel. We have developed an agreement which is recommended by council and been reviewed and recommended by the assessors. We would be receiving $23,380.20 of new growth revenue just from this one field alone, plus $5,000 for our attorney's fees.
Make a motion to accept the agreement as presented.
Second.
Any more discussion?
I'm assuming we're not receiving any taxes now because it is a
educational purpose.
No. This could be taxed because
currently
there's
right.
No tax on the property. That's
so
correct.
Right.
Right.
And where's this piece of property?
This is located just north of the reservoir, other side of the Bay Road.
Okay.
Adjacent to Hampshire College.
It's kind of hidden too. You can't really see it from the road. It's tucked in behind some trees, and you have to actually be on campus.
Yeah.
The
behind Mrs. Kilbasa's, on the side of Mrs. Kilbasa's.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that field out front, the road that goes to the back.
It takes it down.
But, yeah.
So one of the nice things about this is that there's an escalator clause for the next 20 years of 2% per year. So the value of the money that you'll be receiving will be increasing each year.
So are we now so when they build that one, we'll probably be the biggest producer, we'll probably have the most solar facilities in the state?
I don't believe that.
No.
Hadley,
we're pretty close.
Hadley right now is one of the highest per capita of renewable energy producers in the Commonwealth. I think we're right at the top, or certainly no lower than number three.
We're really far up there.
Yeah.
So can't we get a green community designation just for that and forget the school buses or whatever they're called?
The green cars?
The green cars.
Well, I know how to install a charger for one if you want to do that.
Yeah. So
okay.
We lead the Commonwealth with preservation of
land
and
solar.
We lead the Commonwealth in terms of renewable energy per capita.
It's a shame we just can't buy that.
I know.
That's the shame of it. We just can't buy it.
Yep.
It's right there,
mm-hmm.
being generated here.
Yep.
All right. There's a motion and a second. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. So we were right.
The credit rating.
Yeah. So let's go ahead.
Number six.
All six.
Electronic signatures.
Oh yeah. So let's we're gonna do electronic signatures for the warrants now.
Mm-hmm.
So
moved.
Second.
That's per the new account. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's right. So right now we have the warrant, the accounts payable, and the personnel warrants are produced. We ask you all to come in now at the comfort of your home, and an email will be sent out to you. That email will contain a link where you will have access to all the documents. You'll be able to see them right there. You'll be able to push a button saying accept, and that'll put an electronic signature on your warrant.
So
your
we're
going
to have to go through each one of them now?
You don't have to, but you can. You have the option. You can either do the dashboard approach, which is you
okay.
look at the three or four things that you're interested in, or you can go under the hood and you can look at the whole thing.
All right.
But it will save time, energy, and effort. It will reduce your carbon footprint.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Since we've been electronic signatures, when are we going to start using our little...
I was just going to ask that question.
Docs.
Where's our docs?
That is. I'm glad that you offered me that softball question because I have information for you.
Is it ready yet? We've been talking about this for 2 years now.
Well, we have the trainers coming up from Atlanta. And
really?
Yes.
Oh, good.
And she's going to be training us all. We're going to be receiving training on Thursday the 21st from 9 to 12. That'll be for the town hall staff that'll be involved with your preparing your agendas. The select board can receive a 45-minute training session that day at noontime. I hope that's convenient for you.
The 21st?
It's the 21st. It's a Thursday. As many as you can be here, that would be great.
21st at noon?
At noon, please. It would be about 45 minutes of your time.
January 21st.
Yeah,
a couple days.
Send out a
reminder email.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I know. I have that Tuesday off that week.
We can give you the cliff notes. Once we know how to do it, then we can.
I don't want cliff notes. I need visual.
I'll come train you.
You will. That's good.
We'll train you.
Okay. Are they going to bring up food from the varsity when they come?
I'll suggest it.
It's actually pretty nasty by the time it travels all the way up here, so I wouldn't know.
All right.
All right.
We'll figure it out.
So. I left the budget to the end so we can take as much time or as little time as we want to talk about it.
Little.
We still need to talk about next week's meeting, correct?
Right.
Yeah, well, I thought we'd roll that into this, too.
Okay.
So, the 5-year budget forecast, we did meet, the finance committee did meet, and they're still kind of going over the numbers. They didn't really agree.
Right, we were asking them to agree on the revenue as a starting point.
Right.
Do you know if there was...
So they're going to meet again next Wednesday at 6 o'clock over at the school. They'll meet for an hour before your municipal all-boards meeting.
We're at 6:30.
Yeah,
we're at 6:30.
We're at 6:30. You're at 6:30 then. They'll meet at 5:30 for an hour beforehand. And they're also going to go over the preliminary warrant. So I'm just giving you that information.
Okay. All right, so then one of the things that's going to feed into this year's budget is going to be our meeting next week. So I know Jerry has a lot of feelings in what he wants to try to accomplish in that, so I'll let you go first.
First of all, I want to give everybody the opportunity to make sure everybody understands that we'd like them to bring anything that they feel is pertinent information for all the boards to communicate. Last night, I think a lot of people watched the planning board meeting, and I thought they had some great information at the end there where they want to get information out to everybody regarding what's going on, where it's going on, how it's going on, and what they have coming forth with the planning. I think conservation is going to have a lot of information available for us that they'll want to speak to. And I think the boards need to work a little better in unison together just and understand, you know, what's going on, what are the issues. The last time we did this, Joyce was on the board at that time with us. We, you know, Lowe's was coming up. And everybody was just, you know, thinking this and that and the other thing about what was going on with Lowe's. I think similar to what people have for questions regarding the library now. You know, what's going on is Hooker School coming down, what's going on with Russell School. And, you know, we have a lot of different people working on individual things, and not people, but we have different boards working on individual things in this town. And I think it's very imperative for everybody to sit down in the same room every once in a while and say, okay, everybody, this is what we're thinking. This is kind of the way they're going in this department. The Municipal Buildings Committee has some, you know, strong opinions on things that they'd like to see get done, and I think that they need to provide information regarding the building so that people that are not necessarily sitting in or hearing those meetings are kind of cognizant of what else is going on in this town. So,
is the Council on Aging invited? They're invited,
correct?
Everyone
has been invited.
Right.
Yes. Okay. All boards, all committees, all departments have been invited. They've been instructed how to post. And it's an open meeting. I've received a number of telephone calls based upon the article that came out in the Gazette the other day, and I think that there's going to be some people from the public who are going to be attending and will wish to address the issue.
So I think one thing that's going to be critically important is an agenda that we stick to, because a meeting like this, as valuable as it is and as much as we've been advocating for it, it's fraught with danger in terms of it becoming a free-for-all. So did you have a plan to put together the agenda? I mean, is this something we could all look at before it gets published?
Hoping we could
sure he did. What he really wanted us to all do was to allow 5 minutes to each one of the departments and to the different boards in the beginning of the meeting after we kind of introduced it all, and having the select board be the last and final, you know, commenting. So it didn't look like we were completely directing the structure of the meeting, but if people knew in advance, they had 5 minutes to kind of just kind of speak a little bit about their...
I think we should go alphabetically.
With the boards?
With the boards, mm-hmm. And that would give them all, you know, at least they'd know where they are. And it would be some type of...
Structure.
Thank you. Yeah.
I think that's a wonderful idea, Joyce.
So is that how you guys used to do it last time? See, that was my thing, that I wanted to talk more about tonight.
The last time we kind of, it was more of a kind of a direct thing. Well, no, it wasn't a free-for-all. It was not. It was that the issue was Lowe's and how people felt about it, and the different boards from different perspectives.
Yeah.
You know, conservation and other people felt differently about it. And nobody really understood TDR at that point in time. And they, you know, who's going to have the money? You were talking about, you know, $472,000 in woodchucks. And, you know, people didn't really understand how that was actually being.
But is Guilford sharing this?
Yes.
Because,
so
I mean, somebody needs to hold
too.
The gavel.
I mean, my question about this was, do you have someone, are we, as a select board, going to chair as well as participate? Or do,
We called the meeting.
Yes.
Yeah, I think we called the meeting.
Letting someone else moderate our meeting is not a bad thing, but I didn't know how it was. I mean, I have no problem chairing it and then letting the four of you be the ones who run with the select board to talk on it.
Mm-hmm.
I do find when you have bigger meetings and more people in the meetings, it's hard for the chair to participate.
Yeah.
And then I would leave you four to participate, and I would be the one trying to
manage.
You're
going to control the meeting.
Right.
It's easier for me to participate in a smaller setting.
Right.
Because the other thing I think is going to be really important at this meeting is separating fact from fiction. And so there may be either questions that are posed or things that are stated that other people are going to want to rebut. And so somebody needs to be in control of making that happen in a very constructive way.
Yeah. Yeah.
So constructive way. Yeah.
You did okay tonight.
Yeah,
it
was good.
So, all right, so it's 5 minutes for each committee to start with.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to start with them alphabetically.
Yeah.
And then we're going to give 2 minutes to people who come, general people.
Well, and that's the other
public
thing. Normally, public comment is at the beginning, but I think in a situation like this, you actually want it at the back
right
end. Give the public the opportunity to listen
here
and hear, and then to make comment at the end. You guys agree with that?
I don't know if you'll have time for public comment.
Okay, so then it's all the other committees alphabetically, the select board, and then if there's time afterwards.
Time permitting would be the public comment.
The public comment.
Mm-hmm.
People who have been contacting me have asked me if there's going to be public comment, and I said I didn't know.
If there's time, my recommendation would be if there's time, great. If not, people will be able to submit subsequent to the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay? And it will be distributed to each and every board that's there. It's not coming to us.
Do we have
it's coming
time
to every
board. The meeting?
Yeah, we said it as being only a 2-hour meeting.
And by the time you give 5 minutes to each one of the boards and committees, you're not going to have a lot of time left over.
And that's
assuming that, as Joyce had said, and I'm sorry, as Molly had said, that there probably would be some internal discussions subsequent to the 5 minutes. I mean, somebody will have 5 minutes to talk, and other people would, I'm assuming, going to have questions or other time for, you know, clarification, if you will.
I think after everybody has a chance to state their facts, that you could go back and again alphabetically ask if that board has any other comments about another situation and give them a 2-minute opportunity to address that issue instead of taking public comment at the end, because it's about the boards and it's about the interaction and the communication between the boards that may or may not have taken place with some of these issues that are on the table right now.
Okay.
And I think they haven't had a chance to openly say in front of everybody how they feel about things.
Right. Otherwise, it has the runs the risk of being confused with a public forum.
Correct.
Which is
correct
a very different thing, which we've also talked about,
right,
but that's different.
And not that we don't think
right
that's a good idea
and
in the future, but I'm not sure we can tie this both together.
No, I think you're
the
public's right.
The public's welcome to come. We'd
yeah
love them to come.
Yeah.
And in the end, we're going to want their input because it's very important, but I don't want to cut Michael short of
right
a conversation that he's having because other people, you don't want to know the nuts and bolts of, you know, where everything's going.
Mm-hmm.
I think generically we're talking to try and understand as a vision for Hadley, you know, what's going on, where we're going, what we're trying to do, why we're trying to do it,
yep,
and let everybody have the venue available to talk for it. Like I said, last night I watched the planning board meeting, and they said at the end of the meeting, you know, that how many people watch the board meetings and should be in there talking to us about things that they want to do or are thinking about doing,
mm-hmm,
but they just don't feel comfortable with the way the situation is to go about and do it.
Mm-hmm.
And if they did feel more comfortable, many more people would be in there doing the right thing about everything that we would like done or they would like done.
Okay, so David, you'll put together an agenda,
mm-hmm,
and get it to all of us and send
yep
it out to the rest of the committees,
mm-hmm,
and let them know they have 5 minutes to talk about what's going on with them, what's important to them, what they see as being important, and that's will be how we go. Select board's last,
mm-hmm,
and then we'll have a time period at the end to go back and have some rebuttal or some additional
questions,
comments.
Clarifications
from the other committees again for 2 minutes. If there's time permitting, we'll allow some comments from the public. And then we want to say to everybody else is that we would like, if you have a comment and you didn't have time to speak or you have a comment before, to please send us that stuff, send us everything, and then we'll try to put all this together and then have all the comments on the web. So we're like, this is the meeting, this is what happened. Mm-hmm. You can link to Richard and watch it, and then you can, we'll have people's individual comments up there that people can read through on the web as well.
Right. We have a public hearing a guideline sheet that that we can adjust for this, that we'll have a written comment period and address for submittal. And we've used it in the past, it's been successful.
All right, so what's that? We'll go with that format.
That sounds wonderful.
Okay, mm-hmm. And then really, I mean, people just need to know is, we have a lot of decisions to make in this budget that are gonna be pretty
significant.
Yes.
I think our buildings committee is gonna, you know, need to do some clarification. A lot of people are confused or not up to date regarding the conditions of some of the buildings that everybody thinks we should be using for different venues. And I think for them, to have an audience and feel as though the people were doing a better job of listening, including the town mothers and fathers, mm-hmm. I think would be a wonderful place. I think Michael is looking forward to a forum where everybody sits in the same room, and instead of explaining it to 15 people what he's trying to do, I think he'd be able to sit down and explain what, you know, the concerns that he has with the future of the town of Hadley regarding the needs of the fire department. And I think Michael, I think this gives you a chief, I think this gives you an excellent opportunity to go forward, talk a little bit about, you know, the new faces and people that we have around there and some of the new things that you're implementing in the town. And I know these get sickening if you do too many of them, but it's good when you do them once in a while.
It's due.
So how many people do you think are gonna want to talk? That's another thing, is
20? Is there 20 different, probably?
So there's certainly 20 different boards and
committees.
Department heads.
Could you shoot them all an email tomorrow and see who's going to participate?
Sure.
Right, because many of them haven't posted yet, which is part of the reason I asked the question.
Right.
So that we would at least have an idea on who is planning to come.
Because I mean, we want to save around it be just 2 hours.
Right.
And then we can adjust. Mm-hmm. If we know only 10 committees and boards are coming to talk, we'll mm-hmm. adjust the schedule as we need to.
Well, and the other thing is, quite frankly, I mean, if there's, I mean, and this isn't the case, but let's say for the sake of argument, the planning board said, no, we're not going to come. I mean, that might be a little problematic. We might want to be having some conversations ahead of time. No, obviously they are, but I mean, I think there's some other key players here that we want to have them in the room.
And then we might want to give the building committee a little more than 5 minutes.
I couldn't agree more.
As a matter of fact,
maybe they should be at the end.
First. Or maybe they should go first.
I think they might want to kick it off, and then people could talk about how, knowing that, people could talk, well, I don't know, we want them to talk about what they, I mean,
but
we might want them at the end
right
with us. Mm-hmm. I think maybe,
just in terms of giving people information, a lot of people don't that's what I'm saying, fact and fiction on what's actually happening.
Is it more important to get information from these other groups out there first, or to cloud this as being another building committee meeting?
I think the building committee can clarify a lot of the wrongs that are not being communicated properly.
And they start with a B anyway, so at the beginning of the alphabet, so it won't be long.
Committee. Yeah. Who's first?
Assessors,
that's right.
Okay. So that's all right. So we'll put that together. We'll move that along.
Okay.
And in the interim period, if anybody else says, you know, geez, I think you guys missed the ball on this, why don't we include this? Get that information to us. So, you know, if other people have good ideas, let's keep open to them as well. Kumbaya.
You know, and kind of something that we were talking about, someone said something about there might be a restriction on some pieces of property we own.
Yes.
We might want to have that before this meeting kicks off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'd be pretty important.
Yeah, it could stop a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Or it could, yeah. Okay, so any more discussion about the 5-year budget?
Yeah, I have a question. One of the critical pieces is the information technology assessment.
Yep.
Where's that?
That's a good question. I haven't received it yet. This was due at the end of December, and so I'll ping
them
and find out where it is.
Okay.
Yep.
Because that's critical.
well, it's December. Is it the Jewish calendar or the different? Don't different calendars have December ending in different?
You're digging tonight.
Buddy. All right.
I need to check that iced tea.
It's just iced tea.
Yeah.
Strong something.
Okay, so announcements. I wish everybody a happy new year.
Just to remind people that we have an election coming up on January 19th for the school bus and the loader and the dump truck for DPW. So school bus for the school, loader and the dump truck for DPW. It's January 19th, polls open at noon.
And I just had one. I had condolences for Raymond Shipman and his family on the passing of his wife, Lynette. Our truest sympathies to you all.
So if the board wants to, I think we need to go into executive session.
Make a motion to go into executive session for the contract negotiation
for
personnel and for
collective bargaining. And not to reconvene.
Not to reconvene in open session.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. As the chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board has moved and seconded to enter into executive session. I state that the discussion of the matter in open session would have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote. Muskevitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yes.
Maureen?
Yes.
Chungo?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Okay, good night, everybody, and
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.